Ay, come on. Two people to four to spread. Spread. Dk plus, dk minus. I'm writing a minus. K minus P minus square. The whole thing minus I K minus P minus. Okay. And square. K minus. K minus K plus, K plus K minus plus, comma, okay.
Okay, so you remember we were solving this Stoft model with fundamental fermions and the angular fields in two-dimensional theory. And you remember we were looking at the formula that we were working in, the Lightcone gauge. The Lightcone gauge we were working in was minus is equal to 0. Okay? We were working in A minus is equal to 0. And to find the great thing about that gauge, you remember, was that there were no self interactions. There were no self interactions of the gauge fields. And then we wrote this, we could write down an integral equation for the self energy, which was schematically sigma was equal to 1 over k minus minus p minus squared, which is this gauge field propagator, times the full propagator, which is k slash plus m plus sigma, with minuses and i's through this. Okay, so sigma of p was this, and that then we did some matrix stuff. We realized, then we did some matrix stuff. We realized that because of this matrix stuff, all of sigma was purely in the gamma plus direction. And so we called the coefficient of gamma plus, whatever it was, I sigma. Okay, and then we wrote down this integral equation. For see, this equation, more precisely, became that equation. You remember this? Any questions or comments about this? Okay, great. Fine. So now let's proceed with solving this integral equation. Okay. So now, the first thing you notice here is that on the left-hand side, we've got gamma of p. Where does p appear on the right-hand side? Where does p appear on the right-hand side? Well, it appears only in the gauge field propagator. Okay? It appears only in the gauge field propagator, and it appears only as p minus. Okay? So, at least naively, this expression, this tells us that I, that this gamma here, is a function only of p minus. Okay? It's not a function of p plus. Now let's see. You see, we needed to get a Lorentz invariant answer, because our gauge preserves Lorentz invariants, preserves boosts. Okay? Now, you remember that we had something like this thing was proportional to gamma plus. That sigma is equal to gamma plus times whatever.
Gamma minus. Because gamma plus into gamma minus
gave
1 and
we
had 1
gamma. Yeah, you're right. Gamma minus. Thank you. Gamma minus times whatever. Thank you. So this object should have the charge of a P plus.
the charge of a 1 over p minus. Okay? So you might expect that roughly our answer is going to be something like gamma minus by p minus. Because what else could it be? Okay? Because what else could it be? It has to depend only on p minus. Cannot depend on p plus. So there cannot be a dependence on p square, which is a Lorentz scalar. Okay? It can depend on the mass. The mass can just come up here in the manner needed to fix up dimensions. Okay? So roughly this might be our expectation. And now we'll see how that's born. Again, that is what you might roughly expect to start with. But we'll see how it actually works. Okay. Now, firstly, the fact that that this object here. Okay. The first thing that we do is this: we take this k plus k minus integral and separate out the integral. We first do the k plus integral. Okay? Now, k plus integral is very easy to do because it appears only here. K plus appears only here. Okay? So this part goes along to the right, this part goes along to the right, and we're just doing an integral of the form, you know, 1 over ax plus b in the denominator. Okay? This is a trivial integral to do. So you do that integral. Let me tell you. Okay, so now that integral is a bit tricky to do. So let's focus on it for a little bit. So the integral we wish to do is dk plus over m squared minus 2k minus k plus sigma of k by that. Right. The first side, this looks like a completely straightforward thing to do. But if you look at it once again, you see that this integral has one subtlety, namely that at large k plus it behaves like dk plus by k plus. Okay? At large k plus it behaves like dk plus by k plus. And therefore it appears as if this integral diverges. Okay? So we're encountering our first funny feature here. We're getting a divergent integral in this integral equation. Now, as in our whole analysis of this model, we're just going to follow our notes. Okay? You see, it's true that there is divergence at large k plus, but there's also divergence at very small k plus, namely k plus large but negative. Okay? Now, what's the divergence you see? If you plot the function 1 over k, 1 over x, it behaves like this. At positive x, it behaves like this, and negative x. So why you're getting a divergence here because you're summing things that are dying off too slowly. But you're also getting a divergence here because you're summing things that are dying off too slowly. But this divergence is a negative divergence. Whereas this divergence is a positive divergence. Okay? So these two things could well cancel. Now, all we're going to do, of course, so to properly deal with this problem, we have to regulate. But in this very simple problem, we're in luck. Because if you assume only one thing about the regulator, namely that it's symmetric between positive k and negative k, that makes this integral finite. Okay?
Are we saying gamma k is a function only of k minus?
Gamma k is a function only of k minus, yes. Yes, we know this. Because gamma p was given by this, and p, there's no p plus. Okay? So gamma p is given by the right-hand side. The right-hand side depends on p only through p minus.
Sir, how do we know that large k gamma would crop up like in the large k limit, it's just dk plus by k plus, right? So,
this gamma here is a function only of k minus. Okay, so that's the point. That's why this k plus integral is easy to do. The k minus integral you cannot just do
Because it depends on knowing gamma k minus, which you do not know. Okay? So that's why it's an integral equation. But it's an integral equation only in the variable k minus. In the variable k plus, it's just something trivial. The integral on the right hand side is just something trivial. We can just do the integral. Okay? So, whether you follow our nose and assume following Toft, okay, that the regulator we put is symmetric between large positive k and large negative k. Okay? Now, just to be a bit clear, you might think this is an extremely natural condition to put, but just to be a bit clear, it's a bit dangerous. It's a bit dangerous because, you see, depending on what you do with this regulator, because you've got this infinity here and the infinity there and they more or less are cancelling each other, you're going to get something finite. That's clear. But depending on what you do with the regulator, you might get different finite terms. Okay? Now, actually in this particular case, it's a logarithmic divergence that's largely ameliorated. We'll see that in a minute. But the conceptual point I wanted to make was that when we say we're putting a regulator that's symmetric between large positive k and large negative k, the k here is the k that goes into the matter propagator. You see, there's another natural momentum in the problem. That is the momentum that goes into the gauge boson propagator. And these two the statement about putting a cutoff that's symmetric between positive and negative k for the gauge boson propagator is different from the statement of putting a cutoff that is symmetric between positive and negative k for the matter propagator. Because the two k's are shifted by a p. Do you understand what I mean? No. So, you see, I said that all we're going to do is to impose some sort of cutoff on this integral that was symmetric between positive and negative k. But for that statement to be meaningful, I have to give you what my definition of k is. Okay? Because if I take some sort of cutoff, which is symmetric around k is equal to 0, it will not be symmetric around k equals 8. Okay? Now you might think, well, but there's an actual k in the problem. There's an actual scale of momentum. Because there are two propagators in the problem. There's the gauge boson propagator and the matter propagator. But remember that their momenta are relatively shifted by p. So if you put a cutoff, some sort of regulator, that is symmetric for the matter propagator, for the momentum that runs in the matter propagator, it will not be symmetric for the momentum that runs in the gauge boson propagator. These two are in principle different things. Okay? So the statement that I'm putting a symmetric regulator, once you start examining it, is by itself a little ambiguous. Symmetric for which momentum? Once you see that there's some choice, you might say, why not some linear combination of these momenta? It's a bit ambiguous. But in this case, we're just going to put the symmetric regulator, because the divergence is so mild, namely logarithmic, it will not in this case matter. We're just going to put the symmetric regulator for the matter propagator and just proceed. Okay, so just to give you the caution, because if you try to do similar things in slightly more difficult problems, you can really run into trouble. Okay, so, but let's anyway proceed. Okay, so now what do we have? So now what's the structure of this integral? The structure of this integral is this. It's of the form ax plus b minus I epsilon. Okay? And we want to do this integral over here, where this x here is this k plus. Okay? So let's just do the integral
Okay, let's just do the integral. Firstly, if we just do this integral indefinitely, what do we get?
1 upon a.
Right. So this gives us 1 upon a log of ax plus b. Now, we're going to have to take this x here from large to a large positive, you know, a large positive lambda and a large negative lambda. So this thing is going to give us 1 over a log of lambda, a lambda plus b lambda epsilon over minus a lambda plus b minus epsilon. Alright, so this gives us 1 over a log of minus 1. Okay, plus stuff that is subleading in 1 by lambda. You see, that's the point here, that if I shifted this by something finite, because this divergence was so mild, this logarithmic wouldn't have made a difference. So this problem, there is basically no immediate. And this log of minus 1 is either I pi or minus I pi. Okay? Now you have to do this a bit carefully. And when you do it carefully, the claim is that what we get is I pi times mod of this mod. Then you do this integral. Is I pi.
Sir, I don't understand why this is minus 1. Because if you take the minus term, it's a lambda minus b, whereas it's a lambda plus.
Ah, but lambda is very, very large.
So, we ignore
everything else is 1 over lambda. Right? You can expand that to 1 over lambda expansion. Okay? Everything else is 1 over lambda directions. Okay. Fine. So, the claim is that the answer for this integral here is I pi divided by mod a. Okay? Now, how do you see that it's divided by mod a? You see that basically, if you took a to minus a, if you also make the variable change, x goes to minus x. Okay? The integral is unchanged after flipping signs of these things, which never mattered. Okay? So the answer had to be invariant under a goes to minus a. Dimension, yeah. It was one of a. You had to choose the sign of whether this was I pi or minus I pi coordinated in a way with A, and so it becomes a mod A. I'll leave you to figure out exactly why this integral is. This is a simple job. Okay? Good. So in the case at hand, this integral here, this A was 2k minus, and so we conclude that our integral equation gives us an IP equal to 4 g squared by 2 pi over g squared times 1 over k minus b minus squared, and then 1 over i pi times minus I k minus, okay, divided by modulus of 2 k minus. Okay, and now you see the really simplifying feature of this. This integral equation here was a difficult equation because it had gamma both to the left and the right. So it was some self-consistent kind of equation. You could just solve it by doing it. But once we did this k plus integral, gamma disappears from you. Is this clear? It disappeared because whether we put the limit on k limit k plus or k plus plus gamma, it didn't matter. Okay? So now this integral equation is totally trivial. So
not an integral equation. It's an expression for what gamma k is.
But the integral
over
k minus is still there.
It's still there, but it's just an integral that we have to do. It's not like we have to solve anything. Yeah. Sorry. So that's the equation. Okay? So now let's simplify this a bit. So we get 2g squared by 4 pi squared, so let's call that 1 by 2 pi squared. This cancels and the I and pi cancel one of these, so that's pi. I minus I gives us minus. And then, that is this 2. And then we get 1 over k minus minus k minus. And here, this guy and this guy cancel, just to give you sine of k minus. Because this was a mod, and this was just a k minus. Okay? And this is square, and we have k. D square. Square. 2 pi. Let's get this same thing except. He's got this with he has the gamma of p is equal to this to the minus. Can I let it be? Can I leave you guys to track on the minus side factors of mine? Okay.
Integral is odd function.
This integral is it's not an odd function. This is k minus p the whole thing. It would have been an odd function had been k minus the whole thing. Yeah, so p minus is equal to 0 to vanish. Okay, fine. We'll see how that goes. Also, this integral again has a divergence. Let's hang on for a moment. Okay, fine. Now this is a very simple integral, except that it diverges at k minus is equal to p minus. Because you're doing an integral which is 1 over x squared dx, and that's divergent. This, unlike the earlier divergence, is an infrared divergence. It's a divergence when the momentum in some propagator, in this case, in the gauge goes on propagator, is going to zero. Okay. What is the physical reason for this divergence? Can anyone tell you what is the physical reason for the divergence? Very good. The gauge goes on was going on shell, except that you remember that in two dimensions, there were no propagating gauge goes. So there's nothing to go on shell. But Shubhajit is right that this divergence occurring where the propagator of the gauge boson is becoming infinity. Why is the gauge boson propagator becoming infinity when the minus component of the momentum through it goes to zero? It's a very strange condition, right? It's not Lorentz invariant. So it can't be something physical. Are you understanding what I'm asking? You said this was the gauge boson propagator. It's blowing up. It's blowing up where p minus going through that moment, the gauge goes on, is going to zero. And p minus is not a gauge invariant thing. Lorentz invariant thing. This is not some reflection of physics, some reflection of formality. What is it reflecting? Very good. Very good. You see, why was it so important in the perturbative calculations that we fixed a gauge? It was important because otherwise the propagator becomes non-important. Right? Because a propagator is non-invertible if there are quadratic fluctuations that leave the quadratic action invariant. So if there are any gauge transformations left over that leave the quadratic action invariant, and we've not fixed those will reflect non-invertibility of the propagator. Non-invertibility means the propagator will not. 1 over 0. Now, what gauge transformations had we not fixed? We had said A minus is equal to 0. Or was it A plus?
A minus.
we had said a minus is equal to 0. So what are the Gates transformations that are left unfixed by this? That's Gates transformations are by functions that are functions only of x plus. Now functions that are functions only of x plus in momentum space have k minus equal to. If something is not a function of x minus, it's k minus is 0, 0. Well, the constant function is 0, a 0 Fourier moment. Right? So, these residual Gates transformations, by functions only of x plus, we expect will give us some non-invertibility of the propagator. Okay? So, we should have expected that there would be some infrared trouble at k minus equal to 0. Where the k minus of the Gates boson goes to 0. And that's what we're seeing. Is this clear? Okay, so what's coming back to hit us here is the fact that we've not completely fixed Gates. However, and you know, the real cure of this problem, okay, is to complete that, to completely fix Gates. Now, if you try to do this carefully, it becomes a very complicated problem. Because actually, when you try to do it carefully, it ruins this beautiful fact that the problem. But the gauge interactions are no gauge interaction. Okay, so Thoft, who himself is a master at completely fixing gauge transformations, in his study of confinement of QCD, for instance, in this case chose the pragmatic way. I know that there is this singularity here. That's some sort of gauge artifact. Let me deal with this by regulating. I'll put an infrared cutoff into this problem. Okay. I'll put an infrared cutoff in this problem. And then, in the end, I will take that infrared cutoff to 0. Any answer that depends on how I take that cutoff to 0 and so on, I cannot trust. For such questions, I will have to come back and carefully understand how to completely fix the residual gauge. But if I get some answer in the end that does not depend on how I take my infrared cutoff to 0, the infrared cutoff cancels in some physical quantity, then I won't have to worry about it. Okay? This is a nice pragmatic way to work. So, firstly, what we do is we. Right. So, what we do here? So, what are we doing? We're saying, let's replace this propagator, 1 over k minus minus p minus, don't get squared. Let's replace it by let's say that the propagator g of p minus minus k minus, we replace this function by 1 over k minus p minus squared for mod k minus p minus greater than lambda. Lambda is some small number which we will eventually take to 0. And is equal to 0 for mod k minus minus p minus less than lambda. Just an ad hoc brutal regulation of the problem. No physics involved. The only justification will be that eventually we will find some physical quantity in which lambda will cancel. So we will not have to worry about more careful treatment of this problem. Okay? Great. So now that we have this, we can proceed very simply. What do we have to do? We have to do this integral. So, let's see. So let's do this integral by changing variables. So we'll do this integral by let's do this integral by changing variables. So gamma of p is equal to, and here I'll switch to variables k minus minus p minus, to g squared by 2 pi integral sgn of k minus minus p minus plus k minus
k minus plus p minus over k minus square dk minus. Where we must remember this is the regulator. Okay. Now let's look at this. Let's look at this integral. You see, suppose k minus. Suppose we look at the contribution of this integral from k, mod k minus greater than mod p minus. In that case, positive k minuses contribute a positive number to this integral. But negative k minuses contribute a negative number. Those numbers exactly cancel each other. Okay? So this is in line of your comment. That part of the integral from mod k minus greater than p minus just vanishes. Okay? So this integral here receives contributions only from mod k minus less than p minus. Clear? So what we can do is gamma of p is equal to minus g squared divided by integral minus p minus sgn of k minus plus p minus over k minus squared dk minus. But in this range, the sine function is just 1. Because p minus is greater than mod k minus. So I can remove that numerator. So now we've got an even integral. Okay? Because of our regulator, this is equal to minus g squared by pi, that is the integral lambda to p minus of 1 over k minus squared. Yep. Okay. Which is equal to minus g squared by pi times 1 over lambda minus 1 over times 1 over p minus, and this was true whether are you saying this is sign off here?
No, in the limits of the integral.
Yeah.
The lower limit should be lambda minus p minus.
Well, I was using that this was an even integral. So I do it between 0 and p minus. I get an extra factor of 2.
Okay.
And then 0 is not 0 because the propagator vanishes. Lambda. I'm just wondering whether I've carefully taken into account the sign of p minus. So actually, I've not been very careful about that because you see, I said that this was always positive. But that's not true. It's always the sign of p minus. You see, this quantity is positive, p minus is positive, but negative of p minus is negative. Okay? So, what we should do. So, what we should get here. So in the end, if p minus is positive, we should get a positive answer, which is what we've got. If p minus was negative, we should have got a negative answer. I think we just need to multiply the whole thing here by sine. What? Yeah, you're saying because everything is, because this is dominant.
No, answer. That thing will cancel
out. No, we're not adding. This is the full answer. Okay? And so, the answer is gamma of p is equal to minus g squared sgn of p minus by pi lambda plus g squared by pi into mod p minus. It's where
I'm getting them to compare it.
Minus g squared by pi lambda sine p minus minus p doesn't have a mode. It's the same thing as not a mode.
So you're looking at the region where mod of k minus is less than mod of p minus.
Yes.
And the sign SAM would be determined by whether p minus is positive or negative.
Right.
It seems to be cancelled.
Yeah. Okay. Let me just do this carefully. Okay. Here, I'll just do it very carefully. So suppose p minus is positive. What we did was completely right. Okay. This was just okay. Now let's take the second case. Suppose p minus is negative. Right. So suppose p minus is negative, then what we get here is that we always get minus. Okay, so the whole integral is minus, and it's being integrated from minus mod p minus to plus mod p minus. Okay, so if p minus was negative, we would get an overall minus sign, but then the integral will go from mod p minus to mod. Okay. So the right answer is that it's this times SGL of p minus. Where these are replaced by mod p minuses. Okay? Therefore, we get this times mod p minus. Okay? Now, sine of p minus divided by mod p minus is p minus. Yeah, so I remove this p minus. That's not okay. Okay? Is this okay? Yeah.
Sir, I was thinking when we did the dk plus integral, we chose to symmetrize it around the matter propagator. Right? If we had instead done it around the gauge volume propagator, we wouldn't have got that divergence which we were getting.
No, but actually in this case it made no difference. Because any finite shift didn't change the law. You see, what do we get? We got log of lambda plus something over minus lambda plus something. If we symmetrize around the method propagator, around the gate Gaussian propagator, what would have shifted is this constant. But that didn't enter the final answer. Because the divergence in this case was so mild, namely logarithmic, it didn't matter precisely around where we shifted, as long as you symmetrized around any finite point, you would get the same answer. So in this case, we didn't have to worry too much.
Sir, if we had symmetrized it around p minus, wouldn't that
we have shifted this p c by p minus.
Yeah, so
you see, because we would have got lambda plus p minus or the lambda minus p minus.
Yeah.
But that didn't matter. We're getting lambda infinity. First you understand. See, log of lambda plus a over minus lambda plus b. For any finite a and b, the limit lambda goes to infinity is log of minus. You understand?
Yeah.
Okay. So suppose we symmetrize around some other point. Lambda would have been replaced by lambda plus that point.
Yeah, but that point wouldn't have mattered.
It doesn't matter. It's just instead shifting in. Is this clear?
Yeah.
Okay. In this particular case, because the divergence is so mild, it didn't matter. I just want to caution you about the general principle. The general principle is a bit ambiguous. In this case, since anything reasonable you do gives the same answer, you don't have to worry about it. Okay? Wonderful. So now you've got our final answer. This is the answer for the self-energy of the Fermi. Okay? This is the answer for the self-energy of the Fermi. So the fermion propagator, has an additional piece in it, which is proportional to gamma minus times the energy. In addition to the usual P slash circle. P plus gamma minus plus P minus gamma plus plus N. In addition to all of that, Okay? It has this addition. Now, what does this mean? What does this mean for what kind of particle this propagator propagates? As you all know, the propagator of something non-gauge invariant, the propagator of something non-gauge invariant in a gauge theory is not a physical quantity. Because it's the inverse of the two-point function of something inserted here, something inserted in there. And that's not a gauge invariant object. It's gauge transformations here that transform it by the gauge parameter at this point. There's gauge transformations here, transform it by the gauge parameter at this point. Those can cancel each other. There's no connection between the gauge transformation here and the gauge transformation there. Right? So the propagator by itself is an auxiliary quantity. Okay, that goes into computing something physical. So the fact that we've got a propagator that manifestly violates Lorentz invariance. For instance, we've got a gamma minus term, but no gamma plus term in the propagator. Okay? Is not by itself a matter of concern. However, there is a part of the propagator that is physical and therefore gauge invariant. Namely, poles in the propagator. So poles in the propagator represent physical propagating particles. Okay? So it's important to know where the poles in this propagator are located. Okay. So let's see how the dispersion relation, the dispersion relation is modified by this fact. By this change in the by the change in the propagator. Okay? So what is the usual dispersion relation? It's 2k plus k minus plus n squared equal to 0. That follows by finding solutions of the Dirac equation with the unmodified propagator.
Doesn't this just like to propagate itself from there, can't you just read off key p minus equals 0 if you have a thing?
Will be what?
Just can't you just read off from a propagator? Okay, I'm not
right. So there's this piece plus this piece.
Yeah.
Okay? This piece gives you an effective shift to k plus,
yeah,
as we've seen before. So what this whole thing becomes is 2k plus k minus plus k minus into this guy. Minus g squared sgn of k minus by pi lambda. Okay? Plus g squared by pi k minus. Okay? Plus m squared is equal to 0. Okay? So the poles in the propagator appear where that equation is satisfied. Let me see if I got the sine of my m squared right. My k plus and k minus have been defined following those, so that the space part was positive, so the time part is negative, so this is right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay? Now, let's look at these two terms. This term is very civilized, because k minus cancels k minus, and all it does is renormalize the mass. Okay? So you can write this as 2k plus k minus into minus g squared sgn k minus by lambda plus m squared plus g squared by pi into 0. So if we had only this term, this would just be a finite renormalization of the mass of the gate, of the Fermi. Okay? But we also have this term. Okay, now, because this term is multiplied by something that is going to be divergent, okay, because this term is multiplied by something that is going to be divergent,
because lambda is
going to go to 0, lambda is some intranet cutoff that's going to go to 0, okay, what we see here is that there are no poles in the propagator except at k minus is equal to 0. accept that k minus is equal to 0. And k minus equals 0 poles, as we've seen before, are associated with lack of complete fixing of gauge invariance or something like that. Okay? There's no, if this object here, another way of saying it is this, that suppose we think of this as an, ignoring the fact that it was, it's not Lorentz invariant. Suppose we think of this as, maybe the best way to say it is, suppose we think of this as something that allows us to solve for k plus. So the pole of the propagator occurs at what value k plus? It occurs at 2k plus is equal to minus g squared sgn of k minus over pi lambda plus m squared plus g squared blah 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 over k minus equal to 0. Okay? And in the limit that lambda goes to the lambda goes to 0, the pole only occurs at k plus equals infinity. Okay? So this pole here is non-Lorentz invariant, and secondly, it only occurs at some value of k plus. If you want to think of this as some sort of light cone energy, going to infinity. Okay? So, although it's a bit hazy at this point, you may wonder what this is saying. What this is really saying, and we will see this very clearly in 10 minutes, what this is really saying is that there is no physical pole in the propagator. The poles have been pushed off to infinity. Okay? This is quite a dramatic thing. We will see much more cleanly. It's very unsatisfying because it comes with this lambda and this one. Okay? But we will see much more cleanly in a completely physical observer. In a completely physical observer. We'll see this as you will see.
Sir, I didn't get this. What constraint are you putting on k minus?
No constraint.
Okay. Just
k minus is just any arbitrary number.
Okay. K plus goes to infinity.
K plus goes to infinity. Just because lambda goes to infinity. So the poles in this propagator occur only at infinite k plus. Okay? So it's like very heavy poles. So there are no finite poles in the propagator. What does that mean? What that tells you is that there is no physically propagating fermion particle.
So this m squared plus g squared, this won't be considered as a pole. This is not a pole.
It doesn't matter. We have to solve this condition. This is something, but this is larger than it because lambda is going to 0.
So, but here you said that when lambda goes to
0,
k minus should also go to
0
in order to have some pole.
Yeah, you could get a pole if you cancel this with this. You could get a finite pole if you cancel this with this. Okay? But suppose we do the following. If you take k minus to be any number that's fixed, non-zero and fixed, any quantity, and then we take limit lambda goes to 0. Okay? In that case, this guy just goes up to you.
We could do the same thing for k. We could change the roles of k plus and k minus.
Not so easily. I mean, k plus is special because between this and this, the k minus cancels. So we're getting this. You want to solve for k minus as a function of k plus, you say?
Yeah. Can you do that?
First thing you have to solve for, I suppose you could. You'd get two solutions. One would be k minus equals 0, and one would be something else. I suppose you could. Okay. But it's clear as to say it this way, right? That the only poles that occur, unless perhaps k minus is 0, is that k plus equals infinity. Okay? So firstly, this pole condition is not Lorentz invariant. Secondly, it only occurs at infinity. There's only one reasonable interpretation of this fact. Okay? The only reasonable interpretation of this fact is that that there are no poles, there are no physical fermionic poles. Now, what is this statement? The statement that there are no propagating fundamental fermions. That statement has a name. Can somebody tell me what that name is? If we prove the same thing for four-dimensional QCD, what would we claim we proved? Confinement. The fact that there are no asymptotic states that are color charged Okay? So, if this conclusion is borne out by future, by further analysis, then it would be the statement of confinement in this problem. Okay? Fine. Any questions or comments about this? We're going to do slightly more sophisticated analysis, more satisfying analysis. But, because this, you know, doesn't feel very satisfying. It depends on some intraday data.
Yes, sir. That depends on how I take my lambda to 0.
I mean, however you take it to 0, in the end it goes to 0. But it's, I agree with you, it's not very satisfying because it's an answer that's not very clear. It would be nice to have a finite answer for something that showed confinement. And that's what we're going to get. Yeah, please go ahead.
No, sir, there are no propagating modes for this. What does this mean?
Mass is zero or what? No, no, it means mass is infinity. It means that there are no states that if you act with the fermion operator on the vacuum, that creates no finite energy states. Okay? Then you only get finite energy. See, let me remind you, all of you know this, but let me remind you of the situation in QCD. In QCD, we've got quarks and we've got gauge fields. Okay? And so if you looked at the theory classically or quadratically, you would say the particle spectrum of the theory is that of quarks and gauge fields. Yeah. Therefore, you might think that, you know, when you were doing milk and oil drop experiments, sometimes you would get charged 1/3 because the oil drop would have a quark. Never happens. Okay? Because in actual QCD, there are no asymptotic states that carry any that are non-gauge invariant. Both the quark states as well as the gluon states are non-gauge invariant. They transform some representation of the gauge. But in actual QCD, all asymptotic states are color signals. What is the actual spectrum of QCD? Mesons, baryons, gluons. Okay? All charge neutral things, QQ bar. All SU3 neutral things. Because of confinement. Okay? So the Lagrangian, looked at with your bare eyes, is lying to you. It looks like the spectrum has all these charged objects, but they're not there. Right? So, what we're doing is trying to see something similar in this very simple toy two-dimensional model. Nobody knows how to prove these statements I made about QCD in four dimensions. But in this toy two-dimensional model, if you allow me to do a little hand-waving, which then 500 papers later on have justified, okay? We can see it very simply in a couple of lectures. That is the attempt. What is the phenomenon? Well, if you looked at the Lagrangian with your bare eyes, you would think that the only propagating particles were the fermions. Because in two dimensions, there are no propagating gauge bosons. But what we're seeing, the first indication of what we're seeing, is that these fermions are not.
When we talk about
the masses of quarks, as
earlier
got
that since they are not propagating, they have
infinite
mass.
Yeah.
So we usually talk about masses of quarks, so
then
what is that?
What does it mean? Yes, it's a very fuzzy concept. Some people call it some current algebra masses, whatever. You see, in a particular regulation scheme, once you take the QCD vector and you regulate it in a well-specified manner, then the term you add to the action as m q psi bar psi is a well-defined physical quantity. Okay? And that's what you mean by the quark mass. But you must distinguish this from the fall in the quark propagator, which is what we normally talk about as, you know, when we talk about the electron mass, we're not talking about some term we had in some Lagrangian. We're talking about the physical electron mass, the pole of the electron propagator. Okay? Quarks have no mass in that sense. They do have a mass in the first sense. The term in the Lagrangian. Is this clear? Yes?
I'm sorry, but I feel very unclear on the relation between poles of propagator and propagating modes.
Oh!
Why does it relation?
Why do you get propagating modes if you have poles in the propagator? let me take a 10-minute digression. This is the clearest way to say this is from the Lehmann representation theorem, which I would have imagined QFT1 would have dealt with. So I should have told you about this. Let me take 5 minutes. 5 minutes.
Sir, don't the poles like they just represent equations of motion? So that is just saying that there is a problem.
Very good. So that is the intuitive thing to say, as I'm sure understands. That if you've got a quadratic term and then so let me first say this intuitively the way I did. That let's say you've got some quantum effective action. And if there is a quadratic term in the Lagrangian, such that that quadratic term in the Lagrangian can be written as field equation of motion field. Then there is a solution to the equation of motion. Then when you invert that, it will become a pole in the propagator. Solutions to the equation of motion are propagating particles. So every time you've got a solution to the equation of motion, you've got a pole. But there is a more rigorous, this is one of the few, let me take 10 minutes to say this a little later. Actually, this has bearing on maybe one of your exercises. But let me, you'll have to help me get all the signs right. Fine. Let's consider a scalar field, okay? You can do this, same for fermions, just add more indices. Let's consider a scalar field such that phi of x, phi of y, time ordered, phi of x, phi of y. Okay? Suppose I consider this propagator in an arbitrary interacting quantum field. Phi is any scalar field. Not necessarily one of the bare fields. Any scalar field. Okay? Now, let's write this out in more detail. So this is theta of x0 minus y0 of phi of x, phi of y. Vacuum. Plus vacuum theta of y0 minus x0 phi of y, phi of x. Just writing out what time ordering means. If you've got earlier times are to the right. So this is later, this is how it is. Is this clear? Okay. Now, what we do is to take this object in Fourier transform. Okay. So this is equal to g of x minus y. Now let me take g of x minus y in Fourier transform. Suppose g of p is equal to e to the pi p dot x minus y. So everything depends on here. Of g of x. This is my definition. Okay? Then we have g of p is equal to by p dot x minus y of the thing I wrote times this one, where bracket is this object. Okay. Now I'm going to process these in two ways. Let me take each of the terms in those, in that these objects, and process it in the following way. Let me write this as theta of x naught minus y naught times this matrix element. And now this is the key step. In the matrix element, I insert a complete set of states in the Hilbert space of the field theory. Okay? In the Hilbert space of the field theory, I'll insert a complete set of states in the Hilbert space of the field theory in between these two quantities.
So we've got 0, 5y, then n, n. This is fully satisfied with the field theory, okay? Single part or multi part theory. N, n, phi of n. Now, we use something. We use the fact that in any local quantum field theory, phi of x is equal to e to the power minus I b dot x. Phi of 0 is equal to phi b dot x. But p is the momentum of it. Translation of it. I hope I've got the signs right. In fact, I think I got the signs. Okay, but you forgive me on this. This we have to do a bit careful. Okay. So I use this formula both for this and for this. Then we use a formula that P, the translation generator in space and time, and highlights the rank. Okay? So this quantity becomes beta x0 minus y0 times 0, phi of 0, times e to the power minus I p dot x acting on n. Now let's choose our basis to be a basis that diagonalizes p. Okay, we can always do that. It's a complete set of commuting variables. So this becomes phi of 0, 0, times e to the power I p n times y minus x.
P is an operator that's on the relative space, not on the Hilbert space of field theory, which is P.
But sorry, no. P is full translation generator in the field theory. So what did you say? Okay? Now this quantity is some matrix element. Then we'll keep it. Okay. So this is what we get from the first term. From the second term, what do we get? We get something very similar. We get plus theta of y naught minus x naught. And then the only thing that's different is that we get an additional minus sign, right? So Pn dot x minus y times the same matrix up. Is this clear?
So you're assuming that the n states are the eigenstates of the P operator.
Yes. Yes. I'm choosing a basis in which P mu's are diagonal. And we can always do that because they're commuting themselves. Okay? Right. That was you. Exactly. Okay. Now, I'm supposed to take this and Fourier transform this. If I didn't have these theta functions here, the Fourier transformation would be a very simple job. We would just get, some delta functions. P would be replaced by Pn. But I do have the theta functions. Okay? So, in order to deal with that, well, what am I supposed to do? Well, let me put an integral representation for this. For this theta function. So, let's see. What is the representation I want? I want the representation of theta of A is equal to e to the power I A X DX over X. Let me see if I got this right. I want to write down some contour integral. Okay.
Yeah, I think I got this right. You see, look. Suppose A was a positive number. Then this contour integral, this is an integral from minus infinity to infinity. But if A is positive, I can always close it on the positive, at positive infinity, because that's exponentially subdominant. Okay? Now, so if A is positive, I can close it on the positive side. Then I use Cauchy's theorem. It gives me the contribution of a pole. But there is a pole at positive. There's a pole at x equals I epsilon, which lies within our contour. So you get 2 pi I, but I'm going to divide by 1 over 2 pi I, so I get 1. On the other hand, if A is negative, we can't close it up there, but we can close it down.
No pole.
But there's no pole, so you just can see. Okay? This is a beautiful integral representation for the theta function. So now let's put that together with this. So we get integral e to the power I x naught minus y naught times something. Let's call the thing zeta over zeta minus I epsilon 1 by 2 pi. Times, now let's call this object 0 phi 0 n, n phi 0 n. Let's call that going, this going. This whole thing. Just something, so I don't have to keep writing this. Okay. Times e to the power I p n into y minus x, p n dot y minus x. Plus 1 by 2 pi I e to the power I now y 0 minus x 0 zeta over zeta minus I epsilon times rho n squared times e to the power minus I p n dot y minus x. I'm going to wait for this minus x minus y plus I p n dot. What was the point of using this integral representation here? The point was that now, you see, I wanted to do a Fourier transform. Now, since all x and y dependence is up in the exponent, okay? Since all x and y dependence is up in the exponent, we can now do the Fourier transform relatively. Okay? So, here this shifts Pn0 by zeta. But, and here it also shifts Pn0 by zeta. Both of these have minus signs, right? Okay. So, what do we get? We get 1 by 2 pi I times rho n squared, of course, sum over n, right? So sum over n, rho n squared times 1 by zeta minus I epsilon delta of P minus Pn plus zeta del P mu. Denominator, how do we get? Give me a minute.
Fourier transform, you should get some t squared minus n squared kind of thing.
Are you saying I've done something wrong with you?
No, we expect some t square minus m square.
I really expect that. Are you saying I've done something wrong here?
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Yes, you said the point. Why
do we have a delta function?
Delta function because of the formula e to the power I a dot x.
But this is an integral over zeta, which is sitting in the denominator.
This is an integral over zeta, that's right. I just learned this integral over zeta. Thank you. That's kind of simple. Yeah. But this is correct. Alright? Fine. Good. Thank you. Yeah. So that's right. Now let me do the integral.
So we have
the
function over those spatial integrals.
Right. The spatial integrals gave us these definitions.
So you have shifted by z.
I shifted basically, exactly. Right?
But the shift has to be
in the time. What, sorry? Shift is only in the time. Yes.
Where
is
my
idea? Okay. Yeah, it's what Anmik is saying. I mean, where is the p square? I needed a p square. Where is that? Just one. I'm going to produce, put this down. Just.
D3x, not D4x.
What?
No, this thing is D3x, so put it on. Okay. So, we actually, if you want to put D4x, you have to put this thing.
Why was the Fourier transform B3x?
Because
I was just going to mention space to the property. Just one thing. I could just go and run and bring up quite a bit of textbook, but just one. I mean, this is a standard distribution where am I missing? Let me just proceed. Let me just work out. Okay. Let me just proceed. So, if we were in four dimensions, we get d zeta by I. Sorry, maybe I should prepare this rather than trying it. But still, we get mod n squared.
sofa. Please, you know.
Give me 1 minute more, otherwise we'll postpone it. Just I'll tell you what I'm after. For the right answer is.
So this is the Kalman-Lyman spectral derivation, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, that's what I was trying to do.
Exactly.
Let me see. Just give me 1 minute, I'll just. I'll complete this for you next.
Yeah.
Next class. I'll tell you what the final answer is. The final answer when you do it, in some way it will, maybe you just hear the Lorentz invariance of this formula correctly. I'm not sure. The final answer is rho m squared over p squared minus m squared plus I m squared. Where rho m squared is what? It's this rho n on squared times delta of pn squared minus n squared. This is the final answer. Okay. I'll show it to you next time. I'll show you that. We have this?
Yes, delta of P minus P naught plus P minus P n plus P n P plus P n upon the corresponding P minus P n P plus P n.
Oh, you're absolutely right. You're absolutely right. We just get confused, right? Because we get, because of the delta half.
Yeah.
And. Yeah, you're absolutely right. You're absolutely right. Let's complete. So, yeah, you're absolutely right. Wait. But this was just P zero. My confusion was where we get P in the spatial part. Yeah, where is that coming? That's somehow coming from Lorentz invariance. In the sense that the sum over all states with Pn 0 and a particular value of P has a P in it because of Lorentz invariance. That's where it's coming from. Okay? So that when you it's somehow coming from there, you have to process that. There's a standard trick to process this, which I'm not going to take. Okay, but right. So when you so what the claim is that you get this rho m. Sorry. Then you get this p squared minus m squared minus I m. So on. Where this rho m is what I wrote down. Okay. Now, so the first, I'm going to prove this to you with in the next class. Okay. I'm sorry if it's not possible. But. The first thing about this is the following. Okay, you see this thing here is this full object. This rho m was this full rho m on squared. Okay, was this for rho n mod squared times delta of pn squared minus n squared. Sum over n. Okay? Now, this n goes over the full spectrum of the theorem. Now, this n goes over single particle states, multi-particle states, and so on. Okay? The next thing you can show is the following, that if you look at the contribution to this quantity from only single particle states, okay, then this gives you a pole. This gives you a delta function. Okay? And therefore, plugged in here, gives you a pole. This is totally clear, right? Because what you get here is just the spectrum of states formed by single particles. They occur only at a particular value of the mass. Okay? So the whole thing here will give you a delta function at the value of mass of the particle when you do this. Is this clear? So this n becomes an integral over the d3p of the particle. Okay? But it only takes at one value of the mass. So it's clear that there's some delta function. The delta function setting. Right. So, if you take the contribution from single particles, the contribution to this rho of m includes a delta function at m minus n naught, minus square minus n square. However, if you now take the contribution from two particle states to this quantity, because if you've got a two particle state, you can get a center of mass energy, a p squared, that's absolutely anything within a certain range. You don't get contribution. This thing is not just localized in one particular value of m squared. It's a broad thing. Okay? So, a broad contribution here gives rise to a cut in the two-point function. Why is it a cut? It's a cut because there's some discontinuity because of the ion circle. But the discontinuity is not localized in the point. It's everything. Is this clear? Okay? So, just to say this again, suppose I had a formula of this sort, and what I tried to do was to compute. So suppose I've got this thing up, on the complex plane, and I try to compute. I regard this as a variable. This p squared. Let me call this sum s. Okay. And on the S complex plane, I compute a contour integral that encloses some region. I compute a contour integral that encloses some region of the real axis. Okay? Then, because I've got a pole in here, so I do the M integral last. For any given value of M, I've got a pole here. So I get some contribution. And then I get the contribution from every value of m. So you see that this object here, which this contour integral over the real axis, will be effectively integral rho m squared times some numbers. But if you just regard this whole thing after you've done the m integral as an analytic function in the variable p squared, then this integral just gives you the value of the discontinuity across. So it's clear that there's a cut. And then the strength of the discontinuity across the cut is proportional to rho m. In the particular case that rho m square was a delta function, that cut becomes a pole. Okay? So the important point here is simply that every time you've got a pole in the propagator, there are single particle states in this. Okay, cuts in the propagator, on the other hand, represent multi-particle states. Okay, and this is one of these. Yes, please. This is one of the few results in quantum physics. I'm sorry, I messed up in trying to derive it. Are we any more questions about our analysis of the pole in the Fermion propagator?
The answer that we found that just tells us that there are no single fermions propagating in the theory.
Yes.
Still does not tell us that there are like bound states which...
That there are no bound states. That there are or are not.
No bound states. That there are bound states.
That it does not tell us. So that's what we're going to try to analyze next. Okay? So, so the comment is perfectly bang on. All we know is that there are no single fermion states in the theory, but we don't know anything else about spectrum. So now the next thing that Tov does is to try to compute something more physical. And the more physical thing that he wants to compute is the two-point function of the operator psi bar psi with psi bar psi. Now, why do we want to compute this two-point function? A, firstly, it's gauge invariant. Okay? So this is an answer that should have a finite answer. This should have some finite answer. Should finite Lorentz invariant answer. Okay? We won't be satisfied with getting some infinity. But how does it have bearing on the question of confinement? It has bearing on the question of confinement precisely for the in the way that we were trying to haphazardly understand. You see, because for any operator, this Lehmann representation theorem, once you get it right, tells you that there's the spectral decomposition of the propagator. So this applies also to psi bar psi. Okay? Now, if there are... So the question is, what is the analytic structure of this two-point function? If there are poles in this propagator, that will tell us that there are single particles created by the action of psi bar psi on the vacuum. Remember, this rho n was vacuum, operator, vacuum. That's a vacuum, operator, state, one square. Single particles created by the action of psi bar psi. Now, suppose there were single fermion states. What should this rho, this psi bar psi, create? What would it create in free further? Suppose we did the calculation in the free theory. What states would this operator act in the vacuum create? Well, bosons. But how many particle states? In the free theory, what's the spectrum of the particle theory? Free photons. Psi bar psi acting in the vacuum creates what?
Either
zero, but zero particle is unique, that's a vacuum. But when it creates anything, it creates two particle states. Okay? So, if in the free theory, when we compute this thing and we analyze its analytic structure, what will we get? We get cuts. And only cuts. There are no bound states, so there will be no poles. And we get only cuts. Okay? On the other hand, what we are going to show in this theory is that we get the reverse. We get only poles and no cuts. What does it mean that there are no cuts? See, cuts are multi-particles of single quark particles. So if there are no cuts, it means that there are no single quark particles. Because if there were single quark states, then inevitably created by psi, then inevitably psi bar psi would create a two-particle state. So the fact that there are no cuts is there are no two-particle states of psi bar and psi. That is the statement of confinement. Moreover, then you also find that there are poles, which are like the mesons. Okay? So that is what we are going to try to. And this is sort of like the clinching. The clinching thing. That, you know, helps you understand the spectrum of this theory. Also helps you clearly understand that there are no, that clearly shows you confinement. So that is the goal. Is this clear? Fine. So we're going to proceed diagrammatically. Okay. We're going to proceed diagrammatically. And how do we proceed? So if you want to compute this two-point function, what would we do? Well, we're only supposed to compute planar graphs. So how do each of these two insertions, these lines emerge? Well, we have to connect up these lines and then dress this to gauge problem, gauge stuff. What diagrams do we have? And then in the middle, we can put whatever we want here. In each of these lines. doing that is simply replacing each of these by the exact property. So, if we allow, and we've already determined the exact propagator, we've actually already found the exact propagator. Okay? So, if we, by this line, allow ourselves to mean the exact propagator, then all we have to do is to sum this classifier. Can you see there are no other leading order large n planar diagrams that contribute to this? To this problem. Is this clear? So the thing that we actually wanted to compute, this computing this fermion propagator, you can think of as a technical step in the procedure of computing this physical quantity. In the process of computing this physical quantity. That technical step we've achieved, and now we're going to use it to compute this physical quantity. Is this clear?
What happened in the global one?
Yes, we're in light cone gauge. In two dimensions, there are gluon-gluon vertices only because of a mu commutator, a mu the whole thing squared.
Okay.
But since in two dimensions, one of the a's is zero,
okay.
They're gone.
Yeah, okay.
That was a great thing about light. Okay, that's why we're working in this gauge. Okay? So this is the thing we want to do. So we want to sum these graphs. The infinite set of graphs, it's pretty simple set of, pretty simple infinite set graphs. Okay. Now you understood the tricks for summing these graphs, right? You write down some equation that the sum of all graphs will be is, So you see, instead of thinking of this process as a whole, it's better to try to consider these graphs with these two lines open. And then sew up the open lines. Okay, so let me look at this set of graphs with the lines open. Okay, now this set of graphs obeys the following integral equation. You see, suppose, let me first write up all the graphs. Firstly, there's this, and I'm including in this the propagators that come out. Then there's cluster. Now, do you see that this whole thing has to follow in form? That if you want this whole sum, let me call this whole sum, let me call that sum pro. Okay. The sum of all these graphs. Okay? Right. Then, blob is equal to, well, the leading order. Plus blob. Okay, I should. This blob, whatever it is, has two lines coming. two edges. These are not propagators, okay? These are just things emerging out. Okay? Plus this, sewn up by. Plus. You see?
Yes. The first one should be a blob.
What?
It should be a cross, it should be a blob.
No, this is a cross. This is a bare diagram. You see, every diagram in this thing, you can take all of these except this. Because each graph here that has a gauge goes online. Is contained in there.
So, leaving out the bare diagram, the rest of them are in geometric progression.
What?
Leaving out
the bare diagram, the rest of them are in geometric progression. Yes, exactly. That's okay. So, if we can solve this integral equation, we'll write it down in a moment. This will become an integral equation. Okay? But if we can solve this integral equation, then what we will get is something that depends on the momentum that goes in here, that's called that p, I think. Or that r.
And then the momentum that goes out here, so r minus p and p. And then what we will do is sew up these two ends and integrate over p. That would give us equal to. So what we want to do is to solve this basically. Now, what we are most interested in is not the answer of the two-point function, but just its singularities. Okay? So, this integral equation here, is going to give us it's got a homogeneous part and a non-homogeneous part. Okay? Now, the structure is going to be, we're interested in the analytic structure in R. This variable R. Okay? So, we've got some homogeneous term and a source term. Okay? So, when will we get singularities of the full equation? Only when there are solutions of the homogeneous equation without the source term. Okay? Do you see that? Suppose we've got a general linear equation, doesn't matter for the details. I've got a linear equation, which is A, which is some function of R, okay, on the variable we're interested in, is equal to some source. If we're looking for singularities of this equation in R, there are two possible sources. A, that the source has a singularity. In our case, that's not the case. The source is just a free diagonal. There's no singularity. So the only other possibility is that A has a zero. Okay? So then at any non-singular value of the source, when we invert this, psi is equal to S psi of A, appropriately said, we'll get a singularity inside. Okay? So, another way of saying it is that singularity is in the solution of such equations. The solutions of equations, homogeneous equations with a source, are always associated with the zeros of the homogeneous part. Is this clear?
Because the zeros will drop from the spoons.
Because the you have to invert.
Yeah.
Because we'll put that down. Okay? So if we're interested not in the full problem, not in the full two-point function, which we could be, but only in its singularities, then we don't even have to bother about solving this equation with the source. We can just take the homogeneous equation and try to solve for the homogeneous equation. The solutions, the non-trivial solutions of the homogeneous equation will give us all the singularities of the two-point function that we're after. Is this clear? This is sometimes called the equation here without the source term and with this open and not closed is sometimes called the Bethe-Salpeter equation. Okay? Bethe and Salpeter use the kind of logic that I'm saying. I'm not sure what logic they use, but they argue that this solution, the solution of this equation, gives you the spectrum. You see, we've argued the same thing because we've argued that singularities of the two-point function are obtained by this. The singularities, as we've from the Lehmann representation theorem, are associated with the spectrum. Okay?
So that's
not
infinity, right?
What?
Cuts are definitely different times
of
variety. Okay, cuts, this will not work.
No. Even if we have cuts, this will work. You see, if this thing was
was an analytic function. Okay, if this was an analytic function, then this would be completely analytic. So the only possibility is that you've got some zero of this thing, if you've got a non-analytic thing. Okay, now the point will be that these, you see, the way it will happen is that you will have many zeros integrated. And that will ameliorate the extent of the non-analyticity. You can always think of the of a cup as being an integral over poles. And that's how it's going to work. Okay? So either you will get isolated zeros, which will give rise to poles, or you will get a continuum of zeros, which will give rise to cuts. Is it clear? Okay? And that's just, you should just think of this now like in the sense of a Schrodinger equation. It's a little like this guy, the homogeneous equation, is the bound state Schrodinger equation for your problem. Okay? Either you will find solutions at isolated points in energy, in this case S square, or you will find continuous solutions. And that will basically determine when you have poles or cuts. Okay? Great. So, what we need to do now is just focus on this homogeneous equation and try to take this homogeneous equation and look for its solutions. Okay, so let's be quick about this. Okay. Now see, okay, so suppose we had this object, this blob, which I'm giving a psi of P and R. This is R and this is P. R is the center of mass, I mean the momentum that goes through the process. P is the division of the momentum between up and down. Okay. Now, this psi here, really speaking, we've got some index here and some index there. Right, some Dirac index up there and some Dirac index down. Okay? But because we've got a gamma minus, because the interaction, okay, comes with a gamma minus, okay, only one part of that can matter. So let's say this is a little better. So this psi really was some, let's put some alpha index here and some beta index. Okay? So let's write down now, let's put an alpha and a beta here. And let's write down the integral equation and then put this here. Okay. So what we will get is psi alpha beta of P. Then we're supposed to put this gate Gauss propagator that goes in this. Okay? This gate Gauss propagator can contain some momentum. Let's call it L. And that will change the effective P and R. Okay, so what we will get is, so let's draw that diagrammatically. So, on the left hand side, we just got psi PR. Here, what we had is psi P minus L plus R, and let's say L plus R. Sorry, P minus L. Okay, sorry, let's say both momenta are going out. So this is R minus P plus L, and this is P. Then we had the momentum L going up here. Yeah? So this becomes momentum R minus P. So and this was P minus. P minus L. P plus L. and this becomes P. Okay? So the equation becomes psi alpha beta of psi alpha beta of P plus L and both this alpha index and the beta index are multiplied by gamma minus. You see, because we've got this gamma minus factor. Okay? So we would get gamma minus, the one that is gamma minus transpose. So what we would get is a gamma minus here, a gamma minus here, and then the propagator. Right? So let me write it out and I'll fix the transpose. So we get psi alpha beta.
You're saying this right.
Gamma minus beta theta. Gamma minus alpha phi times 1 over L minus the whole thing squared. This is of P plus L R. Okay? Integrated D, and then of course we have to attach. We have to attach this to these propagators. So these propagators are 1 over P slash plus gamma plus M theta A and 1 over R minus P slash plus gamma R minus P plus M phi. And this is our final question. I put all indices just to be clear. if we wrote this in terms, let me write this as a matrix quantum. So let me run this as a matrix product. So this beta, the only thing is that this guy needs a transpose, and that needs phi. So I think that when you write it in, this becomes L minus the root mean squared. So suppose I write this psi as a matrix. This will become psi gamma minus 1 over that's beta, theta, and theta A. 1 over B slash plus gamma plus M, and then this is a transpose, that's gamma minus transpose, and this is 1 over R minus P over X slash plus gamma plus M, also transpose. Okay, so psi as a matrix P is equal to this B to L square times psi at R and P. This object here, we can deduce what the gamma what the index structure of the sign must be. Okay, why? Because as before, we can take this propagator and make it a simple denominator times a matrix in the numerator. Okay, if we do that, you see, there are two possibilities here. You could get the contribution that was proportional to identity, which will lead this gamma minus, or you could get the contribution that was proportional to gamma plus, which would make it identity. Okay, so this thing is either gamma minus or so what we've got here is psi, and then we get either an identity which is gamma minus gamma plus or gamma minus. Okay? And on the right hand side you get something very similar with the transposes. So either you get gamma minus transpose or you get identity. Now, we are interested in the end, this thing coming about and contracting with itself. Okay? So, we are interested in the final contribution of this, which is identity. Okay? So, we want something here that in the end will give us identity. Now, how will that work? How will that work?
Sorry, I don't understand. Why do you want identity again?
What? Sorry?
Why do you want identity?
Because we're interested in this two-point function. So we're interested in tracing the indices of the integral. Interested in taking this, this side-by-side trace. And we, if it was proportional to any gamma structure, we can get zero. The index structure should be proportional to your identity. Just one minute. No, that's gamma minus transpose. Gamma minus transpose is gamma plus. Just one minute. If you have part of size that's proportional to gamma plus, that goes away because gamma plus squared is 0. The only thing that contributes is the part that's proportional to identity. Okay? So, whatever appears on the left-hand side, on the right-hand side, we only get contributions from the part that's proportional to identity. Okay? Now, the left-hand side may have other terms as well. But we're only interested in the part of psi that's proportional to identity, because we want to compute this two-point function. Okay? So we just simply set psi to be proportional to identity. Okay? That would have been inconsistent had the contribution, if we had the left-hand side contribution have got mixing from the parts of psi that were not proportional to identity. But because that doesn't happen, because we've got this gamma minus transpose psi, we can just simply set gamma minus to be proportional. And we can just, since we're interested in the identity part, just take the trace of this equation. Okay? So let's do that. Therefore, what we have is psi of PR is equal to 1 by L minus 30 squared. Trace of this part has eaten up this psi minus psi plus, they've eaten each other up, psi minus psi plus. Just sigma minus sigma plus. Just 1. Okay?
Okay, well, let's write that. 1 by L minus the whole thing squared, 1 over this R minus P slash plus gamma plus M. Okay, then transpose, then pick up this gamma minus transpose, gamma minus and 1 over P slash plus gamma plus M.
Why don't the identity parts come?
So since we take both identities, why don't they come? If you take one identity and one gamma plus, it cannot contribute. Just from gamma charge. What I'm not saying is that terms with both identity do not contribute. Okay, so the only terms that contribute here, that can contribute here, are if you take gamma plus transpose, and identity. But for some reason, the identity part does not contribute. Okay, let me tell you about this next time, okay? It's true, for some reason the identity term does not contribute. I cannot say that at the moment.
Contributing will be inconsistent, because then there will be a part proportional to 1,000,000. It is not proportional to identity. And the left-hand side is proportional to identity.
No, but we take that trace. Now we just isolate it.
We know the trace, the equation valid. No?
Right, the equation valid in the trace. Yes. Go on.
And then, if it contributed, there would be an inconsistency.
Oh, and tell me why?
Because gamma plus gamma minus part is 1,000, not 1,001. So that two eigenvalues would be different. And the two.
I didn't understand. Say that again, please.
Because the identity part is proportional to 1,000.
What do you mean 1,000?
One on the diagonals and the other three elements 0.
Identity part. Oh, you're saying gamma. This yes, term
will make it.
Yeah. So this is like 0,0,1. I see.
0,0,1.
And times 0,1,0,0. Something like this. And you're saying that this has an expression only in the first row and last column. So it's proportional to 0,1,0,0. This is what you're saying.
It's proportional to 0,0,0,1.
Huh.
One of the diagonal elements. Thank you, yes.
Yeah.
In
this case, second
one is. Here. Yeah. Yes. And why would this be an inconsistency again?
Because the left hand side is proportional to identity.
No, but we're only looking at the part of the left hand side. You see, if the left hand side had a and other terms, we don't care about them.
Okay. Let me just drop this.
No, but if the part of the... Yeah. Okay. Let me give you a clean answer next time. Yeah. Since I want to finish this analysis. Two things to care about. Okay. If we somehow assume that the identity part does not contribute, I can't see that. Okay. But if we do that, then we get the equation psi of PR is equal to integral 1 by L minus the root of squared. I L minus squared twice. Okay, and then this becomes R minus P the root of squared. Okay, let's be clearer. This is the full propagator, right? So 2R minus R minus P minus R minus P plus. Then this R minus P plus was shifted also by gamma. So plus R minus P minus gamma plus M squared plus I epsilon. Then we get the same thing but with P. So 2P minus P plus P minus gamma plus M squared plus I epsilon. Okay? And then we got the numerators, which were P minus and R minus P. And then, of course, we've got psi of
P plus L. Yeah. Okay, this is our equation.
Okay, I'll explain by the again. I the code don't quite see that. I'll explain that.
Okay. Okay, this, and then there's some factors of G squared. Because of the two vertex factors, the factor of G squared, you would get is 4G squared. And there's minus 1 by I. Okay, this is the equation that Dr. X. Okay. Now, this thing is integrated D to L. So we're interested in this in the integral of this the right hand side D to L. Now notice that here we have L minuses in the answer, but we have no L pluses in this curve. Okay, so if we just take the left hand side and integrate it over L plus, then both the left hand side and the right hand side will depend only on, not on psi, which is a function of both p. Okay, by the way, r here is a fixed variable. R is not changing. So as far as the structure of this equation is concerned, r is a parameter. The variable in the equation is this p. Do you understand what I mean? I mean, the mixing is happening because psi of p is obeys an equation which depends on psi on all p primes. But r on the left hand side and r on the right hand side are the same. So this is like a matrix equation. You should think of this like a matrix equation. Okay? Where the matrix in this index is what value of p. Okay? And it's like an eigenvalue matrix equation. This psi is equal to m times psi. But the matrix indices are these p indices, but not the r index. The r index is just a number. Is this clear? Okay, it's not like psi r depends on psi at different values of r. But psi p depends on psi at different values of p. Okay? So, now, this p index will have p plus and p minus. But if we just take this equation and integrate it over dp plus, okay? The thing that appears here also is the integral of psi over dp plus. Okay? So now we can reduce it to a matrix index with only one matrix index, namely psi at p minus. Is this clear? Okay, so let's do that. So let's take this equation. So let's define phi of p minus and r is equal to psi of p plus, p minus and r integral dp. And we use the same vector of it. Yeah, this fact that's exactly nice. Okay, so we do the integral here. So what? So then the equation we get is phi of p minus and r is equal to integral dp plus of the whole of the left hand side. Now, the integral over L plus simply turns this psi into a phi. By change of variables. Okay? And it's completely key that there's no L plus that appears anywhere in this curve. There is an L minus, so we can't do the same trick with L minus. Okay? So what we're left with is dp plus times dl minus times phi at p plus L minus an R and times this whole kernel. The kernel that comes from this propagator, this propagator, this propagator, and these two quantities.
So this trick is very similar to what we did with gamma, right? I mean, we used the same.
Yeah, very similar. Once again, we did anything.
Yeah.
Exactly. All through what we're using here is the propagators. Gauge propagator depends only on p minus and not on p plus. That's what we're using repeatedly. Okay, that's basically the same. That's why we can do the integral over a plus.
Okay. Now, what remains is to do the integral over P plus. P plus also appears rather simply because it appears here and here. Okay? So now I want to understand how to do the P plus again. Oh, I'm sorry I'm being so long. Right. Let's look at this P plus integral a little more detail. The coefficients of these P pluses here, so we've got two guys. One is an R minus P minus times R minus P plus da-da-da plus I epsilon. And then we've got 1 over P minus P plus da-da-da plus I epsilon. And we have to do the integral over P plus. Now you see, what we're going to do is do it by contour methods. We're going to do this P plus integral by contour methods. Notice that if the sign of R minus P minus, let me get the signs right.
Then we can
choose to close the contour in either direction. Either direction will give us one pole. General principles of complex variable theory. Which direction we choose to close in won't matter. We do that. It's a simple matter to do the integral. You just pick up the residue of that pole, plug it in. Okay, so I'm not going to do that for you. Closing the contour, we get an answer. You just go with the answer. So the answer is what? It's this times 1 over m squared by 2p minus plus m squared by 2 r minus minus p minus plus g squared by pi lambda plus r plus. Times integral, and then what remains is the integral over this L minus, right? So we did the L plus integral, we had an L minus integral left, and we had a P plus integral. P plus integral we've done. What remains is the L minus integral. Now this guy is called it K minus. Okay, so I'm just using his notation. Phi of P plus K minus. K minus or what we call it, K minus squared integrals. So the full integral equation now comes phi of P minus R is equal to G squared by 2 pi. That's this. Where do these denominator factors come from? They come from the pole. Because the poles, let's say we choose to do this integral by taking this pole. This would have a P minus R plus at something divided by P minus R minus. That's what we can write. Okay? And okay. Now we come to okay, and notice here we see this factor of lambda. Notice also here that this whole answer here was independent of this L minus. This L minus appeared only. Okay? So we can rewrite this equation as follows. We can rewrite this equation as m squared by 2p minus, just take this up to the left hand side, plus m squared by 2 r minus minus p minus plus g squared by pi lambda plus r plus. On pi p minus r is equal to theta of p minus theta of r minus minus p minus times integral phi of p plus k minus p k minus over k. Okay, is this okay?
G squared by 2.
Okay, and now a key point is coming. The key point is that you see, so far we've been carrying along this infrared divergence with us. Okay, so far we've been carrying this infrared divergence along with us. Okay, but now you see that this integral here, this quantity here, okay, also has an infrared divergence. So, remember that our regulator was that when we took this gate boson propagator, we just stopped it at some point. Now, if you do the following. So what we're doing in doing such integrals, this integral here, is what we're doing is taking this integral and doing it up from minus lambda, we're just excluding this part from 0. Okay, so we're doing our contours is this, then this. Now, it proves very useful to have complete contours in solving the problem, not to have this broken up contour. So, suppose I have this object here, and I wanted to write it in terms of this symmetric contour, in terms of half of this, plus half of this. So I take the contour in that little region, I do a semicircle integral. Okay. In this little region, I do a little semicircle integral here. I do a little semicircle integral here. I want to see what is the relationship between this object and this object. Okay? So clearly, the relationship between that this is equal to this, apart from the contribution of this plus this. Okay? Now let's evaluate the contribution of this plus this.
It'll be zero.
Right?
No.
So this is just 1 over z squared integrated over this region plus 1 over z squared. You see, if it was both in the same direction, it would be zero. Because then it would be the pole in this domain. But it's in the opposite directions. Okay? So it's 1 over z squared integrated dz over this contour plus 1 over z squared integrated dz over this contour. Okay? So we can write z is equal to into pi alpha. Okay, so dz is equal to I d alpha into pi alpha. Okay, and then this integral here, is the integral from minus pi to 0. And this integral here is the integral from let's say pi to 2 pi. Okay? So let's plug in, we get I times d alpha by e to the power I alpha. Okay, each of these. So the first one is the integral from minus pi to 0. Plus I times integral
instead of pi to 2 pi, we can take 0 to pi instead.
Maybe, maybe. But this really is, let me just be safe. This is from pi to 2 pi. D alpha by pi alpha. Okay. So what do we get? We get okay. So this guy we just integrate. So this guy is we have this I. So this is e to the power minus I alpha divided by minus I. Is minus 1 integral minus pi to 0 minus e to pi alpha minus I alpha integral from pi to pi. Now these two are each equal, okay, and they each equal to up to some minus n. Okay? So this quantity here, and what we also ignored was that there was an overall there was an overall 1 by mod lambda. I was doing only the angle part of the integral. There was the modulus, there was one overall 1 by mod lambda squared in the denominator, and then there was a d lambda, there was a lambda in the measure of the numerator. So the whole thing is proportional to 1 over lambda and something finite. Okay. And you see, that something finite was 2 plus 2 divided by 2, because we're supposed to take half of this and half of this. Okay? So it's a factor of 2. We have to keep track of the minus signs, but you do that carefully. This quantity here precisely cancels this quantity.
So that ambiguity with lambda which they had
is gone. This is a key point in the whole problem. Okay? That if you take this quantity which is also infrared divergent, okay, rewrite it in terms of this symmetric contour kind of integral, then the quantity with which we regulated the problem is this quantity plus a divergent piece. And that divergent piece precisely cancels this quantity. Okay? So now, if by this integral we mean this regulated contour integral, half down, half up, let me just remove this part. Okay? Then we just remove this part, and now we've got a perfectly well defined. A perfectly well-defined divergence-free integral equation for the spectrum. Okay. Now. In the rest of this analysis is to analyze this integral equation and to determine the spectrum of this integral equation. But since it's 10 to 1, I really wanted to complete this. I'm sorry for about the fiasco with the Lehmann representation theorem. I should not apply to derive it at this point. Anyway, so that took half an hour, 40 minutes to our class. Anyway, that doesn't matter. Okay, what we'll do is stop this class here. Yeah? Okay, let me just tell you, when you analyze this integral equation carefully for its, you know, this is like an eigenvalue problem. Okay. And all the eigenvalues will be discrete, but we'll determine that in a little more detail next class, maybe 10 minutes of next class, before turning to the study of Engel's theories in 2 plus 1 and 2 plus 1 dimensions. Okay, so what I owe you next class is a proper derivation of the Lehmann representation theorem and the statement about why this identity does not contribute, after which we will continue our analysis. Okay, the punchline is going to be here though, that when you look at this integral equation and look for its solutions, you will find solutions only at values of r plus, r minus that are discrete. And in particular, asymptotically at large r plus, r minus, the discrete values turn out to be pi times an integer. So we have got an infinite number of bound states in this problem, but no cuts. That will be the punchline. We'll complete this analysis completely next time.
Roughly, when
we are
trying to cancel this divergence,
what's
like this theta function, or is it that because of very small lambda, it's like we don't care about?
Sorry.
The integral on the right hand side has 2 theta functions, right?
Has 2 theta functions, right? So you see this phi. Whatever it is only non-zero in this region. That's what it's telling you. Then when it's non-zero, then it cancels. Okay. So we would put it in that. We know from this equation already that phi, whatever it is, only is non-zero in this region. We are going to then find the equation for phi in that region. So it's like a particle in a box.
Okay. And in that region?
In that region, yes. Okay, sorry. Okay.